good. So we've got it all pressed, I mean, and all prepped and everything, and everything's good right on there. And all you got to do is push the button.
This video is brought to you by Sporlin, quality, integrity, and tradition.
All right, this one's starting a little differently. Had another technician out here, had to put some gas in the unit, and we've talked to the customer. They're gonna replace the equipment, but it's leaking pretty bad, so we need to come in and try to solve some of the other leaks to slow it down until we can get some new equipment. And I was just doing a visual inspection starting on the roof, and pressure control bellows let go. Sprayed some big blue in there. I could hear a noise. I just came up onto the roof, waited for it to start turning on, shut it off, and then look at that. Big old giant leak. This equipment is beat down. It's a walking dumpster fire. The king valve on the receiver leaks like crazy. So I have it pumped down. I'm gonna throw the cap on it. This is one, I made a video about this before. The dryer's going in the wrong direction. That's a joke too. I've been looking for an excuse to correct that, but I don't know if we're gonna get to do it today because more than likely not gonna be taking all the refrigerant out of the system. What I'm gonna end up doing is turning it on and letting it pump down. We're gonna pull down into just about negative pressure, maybe 10 PSI, then we're gonna shut the unit off and change the low side pressure. I only have a high and a low, I don't have a dual, so we're gonna have to make that work, but we're working on it. So we're at about 7 PSI, that's about enough. Now it's still gonna be leaking out because it has that leak on the low side. It's gonna take a little while, but we're gonna go ahead and undo, we're gonna mount a pressure control, and then for the high side, because the high side is actually on there and there's no Schrader there, because there's no Schrader depressor in here, we're gonna have to leave it hooked up and we're gonna have to put a separate control connected to the receiver. It's not ideal, but it'll get us by for now. And again, this is because the customer is replacing this equipment and they wanna spend the least amount of money. Of course, best case, recover the gas, change the dryer, repipe that whatever debacle, you know, pressure controls, all that stuff. But this is how we gotta do it this time. All right, I got low pressure on the bottom, high pressure on the top. I took the existing cord that was going to the other pressure control right into the low pressure. This way I can run the system right now. So this is now out of the picture, it's no longer leaking. This high side right here is gonna have to stay because there's no way, unless I recover the gas. So we'll clean some things up, but you can see that I did it with pressure still in the system in literally 2 seconds. You just put it down, pull the old one off, put a cap on it, get everything ready, put it on, nice and good. All right, we're all wired in. Both of these guys are good to go. Again, this is all just kind of, they don't want to spend a bunch of money, so. Capillary tube lines run. We put silicone there so they wouldn't rub out. Same thing over here. We zip tied everything, make sure that we weren't gonna run into any rub out situations. Look at that little bee right here. It's gonna get stuck in the silicone in a minute. So my last thing that I need to do is check the liquid level in the receiver. So that dryer, like I said, is going in the wrong direction, but the sight glass is not flashing, okay? So it hasn't lost enough charge that it's gonna flash yet. And when I got here earlier, it was running above the cut-in pressure of the head pressure control valve, which is 180 PSI. So we have no way of knowing how much refrigerant has leaked out. So therefore, the last time we had someone here, they filled it up to the 3/4 level while it was pumped down. So we can check the liquid level. I'll get my thermal imaging camera and we'll check the liquid level to see where it is, and we'll fill it up to the 3/4 mark because I'm sure it leaked a little bit out. So this is not a perfect situation, but you know, it is what it is. And like I said on that guy, I can't take it off because there's no Schrader right here. So I would have to recover the entire charge, and the customer wants to try to avoid that if possible. So
just getting the trailer loaded up this morning. We got an early morning crane lift. Gonna change a walk-in cooler, condensing unit, and evaporator coil. So just going over everything in the trailer. Got line sets, some extra wood I had laying around the shop, a tubing bender. So we're gonna get on to the job. Now I'm super early. It's 6:02 a.m. Monday, May 9th. Job's not scheduled till 7, but I always like to get out of the shop. I like to get places early. I'd rather be there before the customer, wait for a little bit, drink my coffee, kind of a thing. So I spaz if I'm not there early. But all right, let's get on with it. All right, this is my equipment that we're replacing. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna pump the system down, get all the refrigerant stored in the condenser. We're gonna cut the line set, lift it off, and then one of my techs will recover it down on the ground. That way we don't have to bring up all of our equipment. So at this point, just gotta put some gauges on, pump it down, shut it down, lift it off. So I just front seated the king valve on the receiver, the outlet of the receiver, pushed it all the way up into it. And it's currently gonna pump down right now and stack all the refrigerant in the condenser and the receiver. Normally, if you just have a normal receiver, you can't take your gauges off, but because there's a service T right there, I'm gonna be able to take my gauges off, take it off the low side, cut the line set, and then let them deal with it downstairs to get the gas out of it. All right, we're ready to go. I went ahead and cut the line set with a Sawzall because we're replacing the whole thing. And then also this walk-in freezer over here is iced up. So I threw it in a defrost while we're waiting. We'll just keep pushing the defrost until it's all melted, because we got all day today to change this cooler, so we'll be here. Alright, so we're going to be putting equipment right in here. We got the old coil taken out. Everything's going to swap. New line set's going to be here. Electrical's going to be there. So we'll utilize that hole for the electrical. And then we'll drill a new hole like right here. That way we can come down, have a P-trap, and then go into the coil and have a place for the sensing bulb to strap. A lot of people forget about that sensing bulb. So looking good so far. Just got to keep demoing a little bit. So we got the condensing unit kind of set where it's going to go. We can still move it a little bit. The line set was coming out there.
I cut the wood out nice and square. We're gonna come up with a new line set and then we'll seal that all up. Looks like the last time we did one, we didn't seal it up. So we'll make sure we do that. And going good so far other than that.
The little things that make a refrigeration tech happy when I'm running a line set and I have this much room, this is a dream job. Don't wanna speak too soon, but it's gonna be nice. So we gotta get up here, drill the line set penetration. It's a team effort because then they gotta hang the coil, put the bolts up for me. We're sending the bolts up and I'm putting the nuts and everything on up here.
All right, my line set, we already pre-drilled a hole, so it's actually gonna penetrate right here. So I have someone down there. There's a hole right there. So I have someone down there to catch all the drippings. So I tried to bring everything I need because we're gonna run the line set while I'm up here too. All right, now we've got the line set run down. We still gotta strap it. I'm sending someone up here to do electrical too. So we gotta get these bolts, we sent them up, we gotta get them cut short. We gotta get that taped and strapped down really good. Then we gotta get conduit ran from that box over to that hole over there, which is the old line set hole. We're gonna utilize that for the conduit. Then we'll seal everything up when we're done. All right, so we did a one piece line set in the attic and I bent it up here. We still gotta make some connections. We gotta reduce the pipe size because the load only requires 5/8, 3/8. Just because this is 7/8 doesn't mean the line set needs to be 7/8. It really depends on the load on the system, okay? The type of refrigerant. So this particular setup calls for 5/8, 3/8. So we're gonna do that. We'll do reducing fittings from 7/8 and 1/2 inch. We're gonna do press fittings, the ZOOMLOCK Max fittings on this, okay? We've already stubbed out our copper right there. We've got it marked and prepped. It's very important that you understand. Let's see if I can get this guy to focus. There is laser engraving on some of this copper. It says Mueller Industries right there. Okay, it's literally right where my finger is, right there. It says Mueller Industries, and it's a notch in the copper. You have to make sure that the ZOOMLOCK Max fittings O-ring is not gonna go over that, and if it is, you gotta sand it down. But we're nice and good, we've got it marked with a marker. We're already deburred and everything, so we're gonna get ready to press this guy. All right, so we've got it all pressed, and all prepped and everything, and everything's good, right on there, and all you gotta do is push the button. Done, and then we got to do the 5/8 now. As you change the fittings, you need to run the tool through a full cycle. Okay, my mark's still there, so we know we haven't moved. Good to go, now we're gonna do the 3/8. All right, so we ran the tool. We'll do it one more time real quick. Change the size because we're going from 1/2 inch to 3/8. Get it right over. Make sure that we didn't come out. I can still see my mark, so we're good. Good, now we need to do the last one, the 3/8. So it's so important that we do that mark. That way, when we're pressing, you can tell if it pulls out. Okay, 3/8 is in. Last one. All right, we're all done. We still gotta tape up the line set. I'm gonna have someone else wrap this up. I'm gonna go downstairs and start doing the evaporator. And then when we're done, we'll do a pressure test. So we've got it all prepped and everything. We're in, we marked it. We're just gonna go ahead. Actually, look, I almost forgot. We need to go the tool through one cycle just to make sure. There we go. There's one. There's two. This one will go from right here. Cool. And this one will go from right here. All right, so we've done all those. We're gonna wait to do this one right here because I gotta slide the insulation on first, so, but we're good. All right, we're all pressed in, liquid lined. Straight in, these liquid lines that come with these Mueller line sets, the soft copper, they're like so hard to make straight, but whatever. That's a hidden spot anyways. I went ahead and used the outdoor insulation. It doesn't look the greatest on the P-traps, but it is what it is. But we're all pressed, everything's in. We gotta start taping up the holes so we can spray foam from the top. I always go with a bigger hole so that way we don't have issues running the line set, but we'll tape it all up. And then we gotta go do a pressure test on the roof. We gotta tape up that hole over there too. All right, we are doing a pressure test. We're gonna get this up to about 150, 200 PSI, somewhere in there, and test it all. And then we've got no leaks, then we'll go ahead and do the evacuation. When you're doing a pressure test, you wanna put the nitrogen in there, then you wanna let it sit for a few minutes because the pressure was kinda changing. We were probably playing with the oil in the compressor, who knows? So we let it sit for a little bit, and then we go ahead and hit tightness test, and then hit start, okay? And then now it's gonna do temperature compensated, and we're gonna watch it and see what kind of a change we get, if anything at all. I just had to restart the tightness test because I realized that I didn't open up the receiver yet, and I wanted to test the whole system as a whole. So I cracked the king valve on the receiver, put that guy on there, and we're gonna hit start again. All right, did a pressure test on it, 220 PSI. We actually gained one PSI, ran for about 10 minutes. So we're gonna go ahead and get the evacuation running. All right, we passed the pressure test. We passed the evacuation decay test, but we're still, I put about 50 PSI of refrigerant in there just to be safe, and we're gonna do a leak search on everything. Now, normally I say don't keep the fans on, but we're, it's minimal right here, so. There, good. And then there's one right here, braze joint, nothing. And then there's another braze joint right here. I just slit the lines, nothing. We got one last one to check right here. So I'll do that and then we'll go upstairs. We still gotta mount the sensing bolt too on the evaporator coil. Got that one right there. And then just to be safe, I'm jiggling the lines, just moving them, making sure nothing is leaking. Nothing, nothing. There's no refrigerant leaks on this, guys. This is good to go. So we've done a pressure test, we passed that. We did an evacuation and a decay test, we passed that. And we took the electronic leak detector. I'm using the DR82 and I'm using it on turbo, which is like false reading sensitivity. Like if you jerk the thing, it goes off. So I'm confident we don't have any refrigerant leaks on this guy. So we're gonna mount the sensing bulb and then proceed with charging the unit all the way. All right, I started it up. Got a couple pounds of refrigerant in it, about 3 pounds, and we're just gonna clear up the sight glass, and then we have to add the flooded charge. Now Heatcraft does a Russell, that's who makes this condenser unit, they do a great job. In their paperwork it tells you how much gas to add for the winter charge, so 3.8 pounds is what I wrote right there. So after you clear the sight glass above the bypass pressure of the head pressure control valve, then you add that extra refrigerant and you should be good for the full winter charge. So we're gonna go ahead and clear up this glass right now. All right, it's very interesting on these new AWEF compliant units, they have, on some of them, they have extra subcooling circuits. So it leaves the receiver, goes back into the condenser, does another like two passes, then comes out through the liquid line filter dryer. And when they do that, you can actually get measurable subcooling. Look at that. Normally on receiver systems, you don't get measurable subcooling, but they have that extra subcooling circuit. So our sight glass is now clear. All right. So now that it's clear, we're going to go ahead and add the flooded charge, which is the extra 3.8 pounds of refrigerant. So we're going to, and also I'm going to pump down the receiver and check the liquid level and mark it for the next guy, you know, because it may be at the 3/4 mark, it may be at the halfway mark, but we know that this is the calculated flooded charge. And mind you, they're calculating it using the flooded charge method that Sporlin has done, the 90-30-1, where you calculate the internal volume of all the condenser and the piping and everything, and then you figure out the minimum ambient temperature it's gonna operate in. So check out 90-30-1 for a tube and fin condenser. That's the way that you're gonna calculate flooded charge. So sometimes manufacturers do the math for you, like Russell Refrigeration or HTPG. They did the math and calculated the proper flooded charge. So we know that once we clear the sight glass above the bypass pressure of the head pressure control valve, we then add that extra refrigerant, and they calculated it to be 3.8 pounds. And again, it says it in that book. You just correlate the model number of the condenser unit and it tells you. All right, so if we look at this guy, my liquid level's now right here, right at the 3/4 mark on the receiver. Don't want to put any more gas in there than now or than that. You can clearly see it right there.
All right, we marked it. The liquid level on the receiver, we wrote 11 pounds, 448A. We wrote it in several places. I'll also write it in here when I put all my data. So we're looking good. We have measurable subcooling at the liquid line filter dryer. The system was at about 43, 42 degrees last I checked, so it's come down a little bit. We started the system back up. Now we took out the defrost clock. There was a defrost clock in here where we eliminated it because we have a KE2 10 plus defrost controller downstairs. I also installed a time delay to protect the compressor right here. So that way when it cycles off on low pressure, it has a 90 second timer before it tries to restart. No, it's 180 second. So yeah, everything's good. I've seen it turn on and off on low pressure. So we're good on that. We just need to watch the box come down to temp. Last things, keep in mind, we have 11 degrees subcooling. That number will change as the temperatures rise, okay? We have, looks like, yeah, something's going on with the pressures right now. I don't know if I just had a bad, there you go. Oh, it looks like it's pumping down actually. Yeah, unit just satisfied. So we had about 25 degrees compressor superheat. We still need to get the evaporator superheat. So since it's satisfied, as long as it's not in defrost, maybe we'll do the evaporator superheat today too. But we'll do that from downstairs. So yeah, we're just putting the panels on and I just gotta write some notes on this side panel. It turns out that it wasn't satisfied and it was actually in defrost. But we went in and took it out of defrost and we're running about 14 degrees evaporator superheat. The box temp is still about 43, but it's gonna drop down. That's pretty good. I'm not gonna adjust on that valve because I imagine it's gonna drop down to about 10 to 12 degrees. We're just gonna let it be. Everything seems fine in there, no issues. The sensing bolt's strapped. So we're gonna go ahead and just adjust some parameters, make sure we have enough defrost on that guy. And we should be good to go. We got all the holes sealed up. We basically up in here, we foamed on the top and we have this metal tape that looks like the texture of the walking box. I just get that from the supply house. Yeah, so I think we're gonna be okay. I'm not gonna adjust that superheat because like I said, it's still probably going to drop a little bit as the box temp drops. So we'll come back in a couple days and follow up just to make sure. But yeah, this is it for this one.
Those pressure control leaks always trip me out. It's amazing how that I had another technician out here and the unit has leaks all over the place. And I was coming out. I had put him had him put gas in it. It was like a weekend. I had him put gas in it. And then I was coming out on a Monday. And there's no way that that was leaking when he was here because it wouldn't have lasted that long. Like that thing just blew out because I could literally hear it from across the roof. When I came up, I could hear it. And it's like that wouldn't have made it through the day. It would have leaked out all the refrigerant. It was nuts. So but it just kind of blows my mind sometimes. You always don't ever ignore when you're looking for leaks and you can't find them. Always go to your pressure controls. Your pressure controls can always be a culprit. Another one, and I haven't been able to catch it on film, but I've seen it a couple times in my career. And this one will blow your mind is if you have an encapsulated peanut style pressure control with the two wires coming off of it. Those things will leak. But they'll leak inside the jacket of the wire, right? So you won't be able to find a leak. And then you go to the where the wires terminate, where the wire nuts are at, and you grab right there, and it'll be leaking. Like, it'll blow your mind when you see it. That's another one that you always want to keep your eye out for. But anyways, so we got the equipment kind of working, right? Because the customer needed something better than they had. This was actually started a couple months ago. It had been, I think that was back in January of 2022 was when the video started. And then now it just ended in May. It's May 9th of 2022 now. So it's been a couple months. We were able to get the equipment operational, got them going, and the customer ordered new equipment. Now this customer purchased their own equipment, so I had no control over the, you know, what type they purchased. I was actually really impressed though, because that condensed unit was super nice, very well put together, came with spoiling components in the evaporator, the condensing unit. I was super impressed with that. But we try to prep that stuff at home or at the office whenever possible, putting the disconnect switch on. If the coils were bare, meaning they didn't have come with TXVs and stuff, then we would put all that in. But they bought a fully prepped coil, so it came with the TXVs installed. But we like to do that. I installed the temp control on the coil and stuff back at the shop. So that way, when we get to the job site, it's, you know, easier, right? Less stuff you have to spend a bunch of time getting ready.
So we were able to set the equipment, the crane, put it down, everything was good. And then it was about getting everything ready. So when I'm going on top of a walk-in box, or whenever I have anybody else go up on top of a walk-in box, you really want to think way ahead, because it's best if you don't have to get up, get down, get up, get down, get up, get down. Like, try to get as much done when you're up there, right? So I went ahead and went on top of the walk-in. It was a super easy walk-in to get into. And we, you know, drilled the penetration to go down into the box. We ran the line set, had someone else get up there, do the electrical, cut the bolts, you know, but we tried to do as much as possible so we didn't have to keep coming up and down, right? So once I got the line set ran, then I went under the roof, started bending copper, getting everything ready. We went ahead and used the ZoomLock Max fittings. I'll talk about that in a few minutes. And we were able to get the equipment installed. We were out of there in 8 hours. It was good to go. We had a couple guys there helping us out. And we didn't have, so altogether we had 5 people there, but we didn't have 5 people working the entire time. We had 5 people. Then after the first 2 hours, 3 hours, we peeled one guy off. You know, so we tend to go over crazy with labor in the beginning just to make sure everything's moving, get the equipment in and out, because we show up, like, for instance, I showed up at the job site, at 6:30, the customer got there at 7:00, the crane was there at 7:15. So we had to pump the equipment down, get it disconnected. So that's why we have so many people, is because we can just hit the ground running, get all the stuff removed. And then once we get the equipment set, the coil hung, boom, I get a technician off and I send them off to do service calls. So that's what we did. And then I was left with 4 guys, right? And then another guy just finished up something on the roof with the electrical. Boom, then I peeled him out, sent him to go do other things. And, you know, in the end, we only had 2 people there. So we kept peeling people off as we didn't have anything else for them to do. And, you know, then we got everything going. So we went ahead and replaced the evaporator downstairs too. We went ahead and sealed up all the holes. It's very important. I use that metal tape. It has a textured finish to it. I don't know the name of it. I get it from my local supply house, RSD, Refrigeration Supplies Distributor. But I think they have it at other supply houses too. But anyways, it's like a metal foil tape. It's the texture of the walk-ins. We put that down, spray foam everything, seal it all up. I did seal that roof penetration on the roof too. Had my guys tape that up. We sprayed it with spray foam, got that going, okay? So the startup went okay. The superheat was a tad bit on the high side, but I want to give it a day to just kind of break itself in, and then we'll go back out there and follow up and check on it. When I left it, I think it was at 13 or 14 degrees. And I was like, yeah, I just don't know if I want to adjust on that yet. I'm going to let it kind of break itself in. Then we'll go out there. Ideally, on a walk-in cooler like this, we want around 8 to 10 degrees would be ideal. So give it a couple days. I'll check on it again. But the box, I was able to see it come down to 41 degrees. You know, all was well. And like I said, I was in and out of there in 8 hours. My other guys, I had one other guy that was there for 8 hours. And then everybody else was like in and out of there in 3 hours, 2 hours. You know, and just peel them off as we didn't need them anymore. So we try to use the labor when it's beneficial, but then when I got nothing else for them to do, you know, go do service calls. So I wanted to address the ZoomLock Max fitting. I know there's a bunch of, you know, contention on whether or not you should braze, whether or not you should use a press fitting or whatever. And I'm going to tell you right now that I don't use press fittings all the time, okay, but I do believe in them and they work great. I have several jobs out there that I've had press fittings installed for a couple years now, and they've been working great, but it's all about the prep. Okay. So I got a couple right here. This is a 5/8 trap. Also, just so that you know, Sporlin makes these traps that don't have swaged ends on them, right? So you can get those from Sporlin. You can get dryers that don't have swaged ends on them. Sporlin has those too. They've got valves, they've got all kinds of stuff, right? So Sporlin has a ton of fittings, they have ball valves, all kinds of stuff that you can get where you can press onto it, okay? So we use these P-traps right here, the fittings are pressed on, but really what I'm pointing out though is it's all about the prep. You gotta sand the pipe, you have to polish the pipe, you can't just take sandpaper to it, there can't be big scratches in it or anything like that, and it's so important, I can't stress enough, you cannot have that laser engraved writing. On my line set, it said Mueller Industries, right? You can't have that because that is a potential leak source. The refrigerant can go under the gasket and go through that little writing right there. So you need to be very, very careful. Now, so always pay attention, look at your pipe, make sure you prep it properly, make sure you mark it, right? This one has markings before I pressed it. So you make sure you mark it, you make sure that's all good. And the mark is very important because that lets you know if the fitting moved, okay? It's also good to mark, if you can, you do you use their depth gauge tool, you mark right here, and then when you're done, if you actually put a mark on the bottom of the pipe right here, right, then it lets you know that you're still lined up to your line and nothing moved there too. So it's all about the prep with this stuff. And if you're going to be doing working in jobs where you have to get hot work permits and things like that, that's where this stuff shines, right? And if you're doing a big install, once you start prepping and you get into a groove, it can save you a lot of time, but you just have to be meticulous about how you clean the pipe and make sure that everything is nice and good. Deburring it, when it comes to the ZOOMLOCK Max fittings, like, you're not so concerned about the inside of the pipe as it's concerned to the fittings, okay? When it comes to the O-rings that are inside these fittings, you're concerned that when you push the pipe into there, that it's going to damage that O-ring. So you need to make sure that the outside of the pipe is actually deburred. So there's almost going to be like a beveled edge where it's nice and smooth and rounded. You shouldn't feel anything sharp when you're pushing that pipe into that fitting, okay? Very, very important that you're prepping the pipe properly. That's like the key to this stuff, okay? This is not dumbing down the industry. This is not going to allow homeowners to go install their own equipment, right? I'm sure that there's going to be a homeowner out there that can install his own equipment. I mean, that's inevitable, right? Guess what? We work on our own cars too. It's inevitable that people are going to do their own work, okay? But if someone thinks that they're just going to go buy a bunch of press fittings and start shoving them in a pipe and pressing them on and walking away, that's not how it works. You still have to follow proper refrigeration practices. Now, I said that we weren't as concerned about the inside of the pipe when it comes to deburring, but I said when it concerns the fittings, you still want to deburr the inside though, because you don't want metal shavings or anything like that making it into the expansion valves or anything like that, okay? So I'm not going to stand on a high horse and say that I use ZOOMLOCK Max fittings all the time. I don't. I've used them a few times in certain situations. This was one where it presented itself. It was a good opportunity, and I went ahead and used the ZOOMLOCK Max fittings, okay? I believe in the fittings. I think I have been using them for a couple years now, and they work good for me. But I'm just going to tell you, it's all about the prep, okay? The prep is key. Now, I'm not going to not braze anymore. I still braze, right? Putting in the expansion valve, you still have to braze in the expansion valve, that kind of stuff, okay? So I'm still going to do it, but on a new install in certain situations, it's going to make sense to use the ZOOMLOCK Max for me because it can save me a bunch of time, okay? But it's just all about the prep. Also, the other thing, you can use the ZOOMLOCK Max on soft copper or hard drawn copper. You just have to make sure it's in really, really good condition and that it's not all beat up and dented up if it's soft copper, okay? So in this particular situation, I did a one-piece line set. So I bent it all in the attic, right? It comes down, it bends, and then it goes down. I did all that in the attic, so there's no press fittings. I usually do that even when I'm brazing. I try to have one-piece attic line set so that way there's less things to worry about when it comes to looking for leaks potentially in the future, right? If you're brazing or pressing the fittings in, if you can keep everything out of the attic and just have a one-piece line set, that's ideal, because then if there ever was a leak and I thought maybe it was a fitting or a braze joint, boom, I just go downstairs to the evaporator, leak check, go upstairs to the roof, leak check, you know, find your problem and move on, okay? When it comes to these though too, another very, very important thing is that you need to support the piping, right? So up on top of the walk-in, I have several clamps holding the piping down so that way it's not shaking around, it's not going to get moved around. And then we have short enough runs downstairs and upstairs that I really didn't need to support it because of the way that everything was ran, it was all good. But you don't want to just have this stuff just waving on the roof with these fittings and stuff like that, because that is a potential problem for a line breaking or something like that, okay? So there's not really too much more to talk about in this video. Is the key thing that I want you to take away is that we need to take our time and do things as best as we can, right? Prep things when it comes to brazing, when it comes to pressing, when it comes to installing equipment, getting up on top of the walk-in. It's all about thinking ahead, trying to plan the job out, having a game plan, taking all the stuff you need up there so you don't have to go up and down a bunch of times, and just trying to be as efficient as possible, okay? I really appreciate you guys making it to the end. It's amazing. If you have any questions, leave them down in the comments, or you can send me an email to hvacrvideos@gmail.com. I really appreciate all the support. It's just so humbling from all of you. So thank you so very much. Remember to be kind to one another. It's definitely crazy out there. Just remember that, okay? When someone's being a jerk to you or something, not justifying anything, just remember, you don't know what they're going through. They could be having the worst day of their life, and you may have just approached them at the wrong time. So just keep that in mind. Remember, be good to one another, and we will catch you on the next one, okay?